In 2025, it will take you longer to read something and comprehend it than the amount of time it took to create it. So if you think finding the signal within all that noise is only going to get worse with all that AI-generated regurgitation of posts on LinkedIn and all that SEO-optimized blog posts that don't actually contain anything good. So we have to move up the knowledge work value chain, and luckily we can do it with AI as well. So let's come back to the fundamentals of knowledge work and find where we can get leverage. Knowledge work can be broken down into 4 steps. Okay, we have our input, you know, the data, the knowledge, the information that we get, and then we process it to get some sort of output, right? And then from the feedback of the output, we then improve our input, right? And over time, we're going to spiral upwards. We're going to improve the quality of our knowledge work. Now, most people spend the majority of their time thinking about how can I outsource my thinking process to AI? Right? And so we're using Claude, we're using ChatGPT, we're saying, okay, you write this for me, you do that for me. But we realize the results are not really fantastic. And why is that? It's because the input that LLMs have are pretty average, right? We're averaging down to the level of the internet. It's got some gold in it, but the majority is pretty average. So what we want to do, instead of focusing on process, we want to focus on using AI to improve our inputs. Even if nothing changes in the way that we process information, our outputs will be better because we won't have this garbage in, garbage out problem. So let's focus our effort on using AI to help us improve our inputs. And the 80-20 we're going to do here is to add academic papers and research into our input. Now you might think, okay, first of all, boring. Second of all, this is practical work, right? This is not some sort of academic research that we're conducting. We need practical things to happen. But think about it. Do you read Harvard Business Review or, you know, McKinsey Quarterly or the MIT Sloan Review? All of these are aimed to take boring, hard, complex academic papers, make it relevant to working professionals, and deliver it in a way that we can get something actionable out of them. We gotta realize now we don't want to be readers of HBR, right? We read so slowly, but if you just feed the entire archive to ChatGPT, immediately it will know so much more than you, right? And we don't want to even be the writer for HBR because people spend their entire life writing a few insights. You know, you can just leverage those insights. If you don't want to, why spend that time researching? Instead, what you want to be is HBR itself for your team, for your organization, meaning that you are going through trusted resources that are complex, that are nuanced, take that, translate it into the context that you're in, right? Create frameworks that make that theoretical knowledge and insight into something that's actionable and be able to share it, deliver it in a way that busy people can understand. So we got to move up the value chain and look at the things that used to be reserved to academics, scientists, authors that had the resources, had the time, had the brain power to sit through long-winded papers. Now you can too. And let's take an example and let me show you the 3 tools that I use to make sure I become, you know, HBR for my team, for my organization. All right, let's use an example. Say one of the biggest things that managers face, which is the problem of team underperforming. Right, they are bright people, but they seem like they don't want to do anything. They're always complaining about stuff. How do I improve team performance? Okay, so usually if you get average input, you might go to ChatGPT and ask it this question, which will give you some average results. You might go to Google, it might give you some average inputs. Let's give it a try. So, you know, how to improve team performance at work? Common question, right? Oh gosh, it tells you focus on goals, focus on open communication. I mean, these are just such empty, broad recommendations that is not going to lead to great output. So what I like to do instead is to use the first tool of today, Elicit. So this helps you find academic papers on the question that you ask. So let's just copy and paste this and see what kind of results we get in Elicit. It's free. You just have to sign up and you'll get something like this. You get the summary of the top four papers. That's for free. And then you get a list of the papers that is relevant. Now, what I like to do is just to make sure what I'm reading is well cited, is peer reviewed, and not some random thing. I like to sort by most cited. I take a look. For example, team design features and team performance, there seems to be a relationship. Let's take a look at this one. All right, what you can do is then click into Semantic Scholar, which will usually lead you to the actual paper itself. And in this case, it is locked. So if you don't have access, you know, to a university subscription or something, you might not be able to see this, but no problem. We'll just copy and paste the paper name and go into Google and see if we can find a PDF version. Okay, here we go. Here's the PDF published by Sage. Let's just double check. That seems to be the right one. Okay, so we'll download this. And then we'll use the second tool of today, which is NotebookLM by Google. So this tool, unlike ChatGPT, unlike Claude, is not using AI on the internet's knowledge, but it's only on the sources that you upload. So you have less likelihood of hallucination. Sign up with your Google account and you'll see something like this. So you want to create a notebook, and essentially that just houses your sources. And since we downloaded a PDF, we are going to just upload it here. Now, we haven't even read the paper. We don't really know what's in there. So what I like to do is to use it as a table of content first. And this is automatically generated by NotebookLM. All right, so now we have a table of contents. Okay, groups is important. There's classification theory. Looks like we have to look at characteristics, some team size, team level task design, leadership. Okay, interesting. Now, I don't want to read this yet. It's a lot of text and really poorly formatted, but you know, NotebookLM is still pretty much experimental, so we will give them some time to figure this out. But now we have a general idea. Let's click back on Notebook Guide and let's look at the suggested questions. Since we haven't read it, but AI has processed it, I usually like to use one of the questions just to give me the basic gist. So here we go. How do team design feature impact overall team performance? Let's see what it says. All right. Well, looks like there are about three components, and we saw that in the table of content as well, right? So there's team composition, there's task design, and then there's leadership. And I love this about NotebookLM, which is you can click into this to find the actual place in the source where it talks about this idea. So even though this giant paper is probably, you know, tens of thousands of words, what I can do is figure out which parts are most relevant to me and actually find the citation of it so I can better understand what is it that they say. And let's say, you know, I find I can't change the team composition. I'm not going to fire anyone. I'm not going to hire anyone new, but I want to change task design and leadership. I can focus on these cited areas first. Okay, so that's the first cool part about the Elicit to NotebookLM workflow. But this is only one paper, right? So what I would do again is go back to Elicit and now see if there's any other papers that are interesting. Well, leaders can learn about teamwork developing high performance teams. That seems interesting. Let's take a look. See if we can find the paper. Oh, here is PDF. Fantastic. So now we don't have to. Oh, no. Okay, bad request. That's all right. It happens. Let's go back and let's see a via the publisher. Oh, it's a Wiley paper. Let's see if we can get the PDF. All right, we can't. If you're at work, I mean, surely your work will help you subsidize getting this paper. But even if they don't, let's see if we can find it somewhere else. Let's see if this is the right one. Fantastic. All right, here's the second PDF we got. We will head back to NotebookLM. And this time we're going to press on the plus sign and again upload it here. Once that's done processing, you'll see down here that now you can chat with both sources. But before we do that, actually, I want to uncheck the previous one because I just want to understand what this new paper is about. So let me do a table of content for this one source. And I will see that it's generating a new note. Let's wait for that. All right, here we go. There are five essentials to building high performance teams: leadership, capable and committed members, norms, a team structure that has clear mission, responsibility, goal, and framework to get results. See, this is already so much more clear and specific compared to the Google search results, which just got diluted over time of everyone, maybe one person starting from the source, but eventually secondary sources just dilute the message. Okay, a way to manage team processes. And that's the fifth one. Okay, great. Now let's select both and ask it to, what are the key components? Key changes a leader can make in a team to improve performance. Now it will look through both sources and give us an answer. All right, so, okay, focus on member selection. Let's say that's not relevant to us. Promote task meaningfulness, and this was mentioned in the first source, great. Empower the team with autonomy. I don't know if we've seen this. Okay, so this was in the first document. Great. And it gives us the exact things that we should be doing. Cultivate intra-team coordination. All right. Provide effective leadership, which means guiding, motivating, and supporting the team. Let's see details. Now, let's say out of all of this, I think for my team, the thing that makes sense the most is to promote task meaningfulness. I want to empower the team, and I want to facilitate team development, and of course, provide effective leadership. So, give me a detailed plan with three changes each so we can improve team performance. Now, you have a high-level plan of how to do this, but it still feels somewhat vague. Even though we know that the input is good and we're focusing on what academics have found out, now we want to do the next part, which is we're going to copy this, and I'm going to go into Claude and say, help me create a detailed plan to improve team performance using, and I'm going to copy in what NotebookLM has shared with me. Now, 2 seconds, we got a 12-month, three-phase, like four-module plan to improve team performance. Just think about if you were HR or you were a team lead and you share this plan with management, they would be blown out of their socks. But that's not all we need. Let's say out of all of this, still sounds like really a lot of complications. So let's ask it, what are the 80-20 changes I can make to my team to drive performance that is dependent on leaders and not the team members to make a change? And refer to, and I'm going to ask it to refer to these two studies, which is called a meta-analytic review by Greg A.L. and by Warwick. Right. By Warwick. And now Claude has a better idea of where I'm getting these things from. And so based on details that it knows about these two sources, It gave me the core leadership action plan. Okay, so task design optimization seems to be one of them. Authority distribution, second highest impact, and contextual support. So now from 12 months, we're down to 3 months, and it gives us some expected results. If that's true or not, we can wait to see. But it helps us list out things like key success factors, measurement frameworks. So let's say, help me create a matrix to better design tasks with clear goals and interdependence structures. Here we go. Now we've got a framework that we can use to assess goals clarity level. We can use interdependence level. We can see where they intersect, and we can even show the team, hey, this is what I'm thinking about for changing how we think about tasks. What do you think? And get feedback on it, right? Now, if we simply ask Claude, help me with what I need to improve my team's performance, let's see what we get. All right, it's asking me a few questions. That's actually already improvement since previous GPTs. So let's say work team with teams underperforming and unmotivated. All right, and see, the plan it gives me is so much more vague, right? It's like communicate and feedback. Like, I know this, right? Having clear goals. I know this. I know all of this, but it doesn't help me. Help me create a framework to set goals, let's say. And yes, SMART is good. Monitoring is good. But as you can see, because the input quality is not there, we're stuck with these buzzwords that we hear all the time. I am excited and optimistic about the changes coming to knowledge work. We can critically think more. We can actually be more creative and associative and generalist. I think we'll have a great time in this era of AI. Let me know how you feel about it. Check out this video on how I use AI to create McKinsey-style visuals. And I'll see you in the next video. Bye.